Hello, friends. Welcome to our last afternoon. I can't believe these last few sessions have just been zipping by, just crazy. So our youth pastors, Curtis and Debbie Hall, you've probably seen them kicking around here, even if you don't know them by name yet. Curtis told me a story just a month or two ago. If you don't know, or if you're not from the southern tier of New York State, we get snow up here. Just a little bit. Those poor Buffalo folks, I really feel bad for those guys. They get a whole lot more snow than even we do. But Curtis was telling me a story because during the winter months, he makes extra money by snow plowing. And it happens a lot at night. So he's on one of these sessions where he's going through the night and just probably 8, 10, 12 hours. Just one of these, you know, one of these downpours where the snow just doesn't stop. And so he's through the night. So he's probably like 4, 5, 6 hours in. But he's having a good alone time with the Lord. He's just, I mean, how many of you know, like, you can be exhausted and just have great connectivity with the Lord? And so he's telling the story, and God comes to him. He's like, "Hey, how you doing?" And Kurt's like, "Man, I'm exhausted. I'm just really, really tired." And Holy Spirit says, "Do you want me to help you out a little?" And Kurt's like, "Yeah, I'll take it." And He describes it like a drop in a pond just kind of hit the top of his head and just hit his whole body. And all of a sudden, like, he grabs on the steering wheel because he does one of these. Like, and he was good for the whole rest of the night. So how many of you know God cares about us? You know, like, all of us. It's not just our spirit, man. It's not just our soul. It's the whole thing. It's the whole kit and caboodle. So I just want to encourage you this afternoon as we get ready to kick off again with Sister Brother. If you're just fatigued in your mortal frame, if you're just fatigued physically, can you just stand up? We're all going to stand up here in a second, but if you know, and it could be the conference is wearing you out. Okay, I've got a couple volunteers who I'm just praying refreshing over right now. Maybe the conference is wearing out, maybe you're just physically fatigued. Okay, that's just something that's hitting you right now. I really feel like Holy Spirit, do you feel that in the atmosphere? I don't know if you're getting that. I feel like Holy Spirit's just going to refresh some folks right now, quickening mortal bodies. So Holy Spirit, we just ask you to come. We just ask you to come. We have loved partying with you this week. I think back to that moment in the book of Acts when it just skates by the fact Jesus spent 40 days teaching them about the things of the kingdom. Can you imagine a 40-day conference with Jesus? Oh, wow. And we're exhausted after 4, God. More. Holy Spirit, we just ask for more new. God, we ask for an anointing on Bill and Ted today as they prepare for what's going to be presented. We know that it's going to be your heart, so we come with expectation. But Holy Spirit, right now, I ask you to do something for us. I just ask you in the name of Jesus to just right now, I see even just very gold, shimmery, even multicolor beams just hitting several people in the room right now. I just ask for a refreshing Holy Spirit in our mortal frame. Our spirits are so alive. They're just so alive in your presence, God. But we want our flesh and soul to cry out, okay? So we come into alignment with your desire to have us be whole. And we ask for you to refresh us. I ask for a spirit of refreshing and restoration to fall on individuals right now that are just exhausted. Just exhausted. Fill us up, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Everybody else, just stand up and let's just honor the Lord with our worship.
You can be the fire down in my soul. It's not what I've done, for you have overcome. Grace I couldn't afford, your love is open the door, hope is secure. Brought me into your life. I believe you are faithful. I believe you are good. I believe you are faithful. I believe you are good. I believe you are faithful. I believe you are good. I believe you are faithful. I believe you are good. Sing of your faithfulness. We sing. I've come to give you praise, to give you the glory that you're due. For you've broken every curse, and you've set my spirit free. And now I'm alive because of you. I've come to worship you. I've come to give you praise, to give you the glory that you're due. For you've broken every curse, you've set my spirit free. Now I'm alive because of you.
Sing that again.
And I've come to worship you. Because of you.
Oh, His fullness of joy. And the joy of the Lord is my strength. God, this afternoon, we declare new strength. This congregation across this gathering of revivalists who have dedicated their hearts and their vision to fix their eyes on you, Jesus, and you alone, the author and perfecter of faith. Saints all over this house, just begin to add your prayers to this right now. We're not stopping worship. We're just going to change to another form of it. Just begin to lift your voices and just begin to remind your soul of the affixed nature of your heart to seek after him and him alone. Yours alone. Yours alone, Jesus. I declare a breaking of the after lunch coma in Jesus' name. A breaking of that spirit of lethargy or stupor that wants to come over us. And we just declare alert minds in the name of Jesus. Holy Spirit, we ask for you to just release new grace this afternoon. We want to be found not just to have a one-time conference experience, but a life of accelerance, a life of acceleration. That as we move, you move. As you move, we move. A nimbleness. I ask for a spirit of nimbleness to enter into our hearts this afternoon. Nimble hearing. Nimble hearing in the name of Jesus. I declare nimble hearing, just quickness of hearing. God, you said, it's your word that says that we should be slow to speak, slow to anger. God, if we're going to be slow in anything, it's going to be slow to speak and slow to anger. But God, I want to be quick to hear. We're going to be a people who are quick to hear. I ask for ears to hear this afternoon what the Spirit of the Lord, oh Holy Spirit, come. What the Spirit of the Lord would have to say to us in this moment, in this divine, amazing, optimistic, infused moment in human history. What do you have to deposit in us today? Thank you, Lord Jesus. In your name, any saints that agreed with that said amen. Yeah, embrace somebody close to you. I'm gonna steal this from Life Center. Tell them you look even better than when you came in. Y'all look good with Jesus all over you. Yeah. Well, let's just thank sister, brother. I know we've been doing it. Do it anyway. They'll tell you they're just servants being faithful. But man, it's so good that we get to take part in it. Can you believe it? We're in our last couple sessions here. Believe it or not, we're already planning for Accelerant 2016. Yeah. The leadership. Oh. We're going to do it again. Oh, but yes, it's going to be so good. It's going to be so good. Pastor's already in conversation with several possible speakers for next year, so we're just excited. Stay tuned to the website, accelerant.rocks. How many of you like that? Just that, even the website name. I just love that. Stay tuned to that. We'll have updates as the summer rolls through and as it gets cold again. I'm just kidding. Listen. Why is it we're okay saying like as surely as the sun will rise, but for some reason we're just like knowing winter will come again? No. Winter should be 80s all the time. Come on, people. It's called New York. It's all good. So if you haven't already, and you just, how many of you just been blessed by the words that you're hearing from these voices? Man, come on. I was raised with a core value for diversity, so I just love hearing all these different voices and various streams just flooding into this house, and just, it's all God. It's all God. It's just, yeah. Somebody say it's good. It's good. If you've been loving some of these, but you're just, some of these words, we're just getting hefty. You got to unpack again. So make sure that you're going out to the bookstore, grabbing one of those forms, and just filling out which sessions you want to take back. It's also possible to buy the whole conference on CD or DVD, and we'll ship that to you within the next couple weeks here. So I know our tech folks are fervently copying and getting those things labeled. So some of those discs will be available even as early as this evening. Make sure to check out the GTU and iMatter tables in the great room. I'm somewhat biased because I absolutely love both. But if you're in this area or even slightly close, I want to encourage you to consider applying for GTU University. My wife and I direct the school, and it's just been off the hook these last few years. But specifically, I want to encourage you, if you're at all local, we want you to stay plugged into your home church while you get the revivalist education here to take back to your house and set that on fire. All right, so it's not, we're not looking to make you GT folk. We're just looking to build the revivalist in you. All right, so get over there and consider applying. And I mean, the application fee is waived this weekend, so I mean, there's $35 you don't even have to pay. I love it. So good. Who thought of that idea? I don't even know. Tonight, somebody say tonight. 5 o'clock, if you've got a full event pass, it's marked by, your orange band here. We've got dinner again in the great room at 5 o'clock. How many of you love those dinners? I love it. I thought our senior leader was a little nuts when he said, hey, we're going to do dinners each night. But I'm like, I love the food, man. That's so good. I'll take it. I will take it. All right. So I'm stoked. As you can see, we have two stools. It's not because we can't decide where the speaker's going to sit, but we've got a double dose. Somebody say double dose. We got a double portion coming here in just a moment. I already know. I haven't even heard the team, this particular team, teach before, but I have heard one of the guys. And we had a phrase when I was when my wife and I were leading Earth and Fire that the students would say whenever we would say something that was like really good, it like hit him in the feels, as they would say, and they would say mind blown. So be ready for it. Just everyone say mind blown. Just be ready for something of that to be deposited in you this afternoon. And we get him tonight. And we get Bill Vanderbush is coming back tomorrow morning for our in-house services here at GT. So let's just give an awesome welcome. I mean, we know, and Ted, 10 million books sold. Oh my gosh, this is just crazy. This is going to get good. Let's get on our feet. Let's just honor Bill Vanderbush, Ted Decker as they come this afternoon. Come on. Come on.
Oh my.
Hi guys.
How y'all doing? This is going to be a lot of fun because we honestly don't know exactly what we're going to do. No, we do. We know what we're going to do. We just don't know exactly how it's going to work. No, wait, we know how it's going to work. I'm a little afraid of this stool. This is freaking me out a little bit. I'm just going to stay as still as I can. No, this is fine. This will work just fine.
These are divinely ordained.
If they fall apart, we'll put the parts together. We'll make one stool. And, you know, Jesus said, when he's talking to the disciples, he says, I got so many things I want to share with you. So many things I want to tell you, but you can't bear them now. You think about that for a minute. Jesus, who is God, one with the Spirit, the Godhead fully dwelling within him, reveals to man, there's a lot of things that I want to reveal, but I can't. It tells me something, that there are things in the heart of God that he held from that generation, but the desire to release those things has never ever gone away, which means that he's looking for a generation that can handle what he wants to say. He says, I have so many things I want to tell you, but you can't bear them now. And then he talks about when the Spirit of truth has come, that he will guide you into all truth. Spirit's presence, as Scott was so beautifully talking about this morning, that rests upon him within us, empowers us to be able to know more than we think we know. John says in 1 John, he says, you know, you don't need anybody to teach you. You have the Holy Spirit, and one translation I love says, and you know all things. Another one says, you all know, or you all have knowledge. You know more than you think you know. The problem is I think we just don't understand all that we know. So John says, you actually don't need anybody to teach you. Why? Because he knows that you have the Holy Spirit within you, and the Holy Spirit will guide you into all truth. But John still proceeds to teach, and so does Paul, and so does Peter. They're fully aware of the presence of the Holy Spirit, but they still teach anyway. Why? Because God will bring teachers into your life that will unveil to you what you've always known but have not been willing to see. This is how, when you hear truth that goes beyond your ability to understand it, your mind goes, I don't get that. But your heart explodes with a gigantic yes. This is how many of you came into the infilling or the baptism in the Holy Spirit. This is how I begin to understand this concept of being one with God in Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit. My daughter said, Tracy and I were talking about it a little bit ago. I was thinking about this, and she was as well. My daughter said one day, so what are you talking, what are you thinking about, Sarah? And she says, I'm thinking about that the Holy Spirit lives in me, but I live in him. My spirit is in me, but I am in the Spirit. So I'm thinking about I am in the Spirit. So as Tracy's standing over there, she's like thinking about being in the Spirit. And she goes, I just move my hand like this. And it's like I could feel sand just falling through my fingers. How does a revelation like that? You begin to meditate on it and to dwell on it. And we've given you, I think, you know, I say we, I'm speaking for all of the speakers that have been over here, have given you so many things to meditate on. If your mind hasn't sprung a leak by now, you haven't been listening. If it's a tire, I'm inflated to like double the recommended dosage, you know. Psh, you know, and I've only been here for a day. So we're going to try not to overload you so much this afternoon. We're going to wait until this evening to do that, to really do that. This afternoon, we're just going to kind of play a little bit and have some fun and talk about your Father and who you are and And lead you into one of the questions that we've actually been getting quite a bit lately is what are the practices that you guys do? By the way, I gotta introduce you guys. I gotta do this right, in just the way that I like to do it. I love one of the things that Scott said this. I love everything that Scott said this morning. One of the things that he said so strongly just hit me was to know the word without knowing the author. Is rather dangerous, actually, to learn the letter without the power of the Spirit. Well, the Bible says it kills. So, if that's not dangerous to you, look up the word kills and see how that works for you. I met Ted before I ever actually read any of his books. And I've actually run into fans who've read all of his books. Now, I have not read all of his books. I've read some, but not all. Yet I've run into fans who've read every word that you've ever written. And yet when we sit down and talk, they're asking me questions about the author. Because I know the author. And here's the better part of it. The author knows me. That's the part that is just the most fun. So the relationship goes two ways, and I'm so honored to be able to bring with me this time to introduce you guys to one of the dearest friends I've ever known. We've been friends for many years. Now we get the honor and privilege of working together and just watching a movement of reconciliation erupt around us. But I'm just so honored to introduce you guys here in Elmira Horseheads at GT Christian Life Center to one of my dearest friends on earth, Ted Decker.
Thank you so much. Do you guys know who you are? No. But you're beginning to awaken to your true identity. We don't know who we are. Well, we do sometimes. When you have those moments when your mind is actually blown and it gets out of the way, and there are no problems for a few minutes or an hour or two, not even a hint of a problem, where all is reconciled, all is beautiful, love flows in a way that makes no sense to you, then you know who you are. The rest of the time, you're blind to your true identity. This is not a problem. It's the condition we find all ourselves in. It's okay. We do not judge ourselves for this. We only come into the awareness that our journey is one of awakening to our true identity, and so that's why we're here. And as we discover who we truly are, oh my God, and I say that utterly sincerely, because you are made of his fabric. Let me tell you a story. So this is kind of a strange story, but go with it, okay?
Just imagine that, a storyteller telling a story. What an irony.
So there's a girl who goes down to a creek to draw water. And there she finds a little spider, and the spider is drowning. And so she takes her hands and she puts it underneath the spider, and she lifts the spider out of the water. Yes? And the spider stings her, and her hand swells, and she puts the spider down on the ground, draws her water, and goes home. The next day she comes back, and she finds the same spider, and she puts her hand under, once again, the spider into the water, lifts the spider out of the water, and the spider stings her again. And she puts the spider down on the ground, draws her bucket, and goes home. The next day she comes down to the river, the creek, finds the same spider drowning once again, and she puts her hand under the spider and begins to lift it from the creek. This time the spider speaks to her and says, "Why is it that you try to save me when you know this is who I am and this is what I do?" And she says, because I am the daughter of my father, that is who I am, and this is what I do. Now, you will always do who you believe you are. So then we get to stop doing things for Jesus and realize we are him. And only then will we actually, you know, we'll catch you up on that and what that means when I say that. We're just repeating John and Paul. So this is nothing new. It's just that we haven't heard it so often. Now, knowing Scott, you have. All of you who know Scott, raise your hands. Okay, Scott is the pastor here. Then you know that what John wrote, in quoting Jesus, was true. When he says, I am in you and you are in me, meaning we are one. So we'll unpack that for you a little bit. Yeah, I'll let Bill do that. I'm going to draw you into an experience of who you are. When you know who you are, you will be that person. One more story. You know, you've heard this before, that there are people who are double-minded. That would be you, by the way, or triple-minded. There are people who have a very significant split mind, okay? And we're beginning to understand this condition called multiple personality much more clearly within the realms of psychotherapy and neuroscience, etc. It is an actual condition, not something that, oh, people are making up. And let me tell you what happens. When a person can very easily be, I'll give you some fictitious names. I am Mary. And as Mary, I know that I am Mary and I have certain ailments in my body. Yes, I have severe allergy to, to poison ivy. I have diverticulitis. Oh, fun. I have severe chronic pain in my back. I have a lot of ailments. I'm also irritable. Now, I live this way for a few months as Mary. This is true. This happens. Then something changes in my mind, in my brain. The neural circuitry switches. It actually switches. They can measure it now. It switches. There's like duplicate sets of neurons, okay? I'll make it this is all layman's terms, okay? So it goes from one set to another set, and now you have new memories and new identity. Now that person believes she's not Sally, she's Jane. New personality, yes? It's all clinical. This is not, demon possession or all this kind of stuff. This is simply a clinical condition. I'm not talking about the other stuff. Okay? Do you follow me? Okay. Now, Jane, she knows herself as Jane. Jane does not have poison ivy allergies. She does not have a problem in her back. She's not an irritable person. Instead, she loves apple pie. She's happy all the time. And guess what? Whereas Mary had severe poison ivy allergies, Jane, that condition disappears. Her back stops hurting immediately. Her body changes and matches the beliefs in her brain. No kidding. I'm dead serious. Look it up. It's called the mind-body syndrome. It's much more prevalent than that. Many people would say every single allergy you have today is born simply out of your belief. Doesn't mean it's all psychosomatic. It means everything in your body is psychosomatic. In other words, you are your brain. It's not you have a brain and here's your body. The two are connected. Every cell in your body is connected to the brain in the way we cannot even begin to imagine. Science is discovering this. Medicine is discovering this. Now you say, why are you telling us this story, Ted? I'm telling you this story because the way you're living right now has everything to do with what you believe you are, who you believe you are. It's like this. What if you're not that person you think you are? You're actually someone totally different. What if one day you were to find out, right now you think you're Clark Kent? You're Clark Kent. You've got the glasses. Wrong rims. There he is. Clark Kent. But someone, you know, you're going to the office every day, you're doing your thing, da-da. Someday someone comes along and taps you on the shoulder and says, no, 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 Clark, you're not Clark Kent. That's just a costume you're wearing. You're actually Superman. Yeah, and Superman can fly. No, no, you don't understand. And the guy says, I'm serious. You are Superman. You just have forgotten it. You don't know who you are. If you go down to the telephone booth and switch into your, strip out of that costume that you're currently wearing right now, you'll discover that you're someone else, and that person can fly. Bill and I are here to tell you and remind you what you already know in your spirit. There is no new information here. Your mind might be hearing it for the first time. Your heart already knows it because you are created, fashioned in the likeness of God. And remade in that likeness because of your elder brother, Yeshua, who is your Savior. And we'll unpack that more.
And Clark just thought he was a reporter reporting the news, as opposed to realizing he was fully empowered to make the news. I just saw that. I thought that was kind of fun.
That's absolutely true.
One of the things that I think that we find all the time that blocks us against, to go back to the spider, the girl in the spider story, which always creeps me out because I don't like spiders much. But anyway, good. Like in kindred spirit here. What if the spider actually isn't a spider and that's why the girl keeps picking it up? Because she knows it's something that it actually doesn't believe it actually is. Let me just give you an example. One of the things I think that oftentimes hinders people's concept of who they really are, and this I run into probably more than anything else, is this idea that, well, I still have a sin nature. Yeah. Like, it's in my nature to sin. I've been told that I will always have a sin nature, and so therefore that's what I do. Yeah. And I would ask this question, did Adam and Eve have a sin nature when they were created by God? No, they were made perfect and good. Not just good, but very good. I think he said good when man was made and very good when woman was made, which makes perfect sense to me. What's the old joke that you always make a prototype before you finish the perfected model? So, but God makes them good. He makes them very good, yet they still sinned. Now, a lot of times people will prove to themselves that they have a sin nature because you're still able to sin. Well, if I'm able to sin or I sin or it's my propensity to sin, then I must have a sin nature. That's in my nature to do it. And the problem with believing that about yourself is that you always return to that as a behavior, a reference point for who you are. So when somebody calls you a saint, you'll think you're a saint as long as, well, during that little time where you've said the prayer of repentance or forgiveness and you'll walk away feeling clean until the very first time that you have anger against your brother or you lust or you do something that you know is not necessarily reflecting the heart of God, and immediately you don't feel quite as much sinless as you did before. Now you've got to come back to the altar and get it all dealt with again. And there's some people who become really, really spiritual, and they can deal with it in the moment. If we confess our sins, faithful and just to forgive us. So they go ahead and they just do that, and they get that taken care of. But the thing is, it then becomes lifestyle over and over and over again, because pretty soon you can actually, in a sense, shut down your sensitivity to the leading of the Spirit, believing it is in your nature to always sin. You live this constant lifestyle of sin, repentance, because that's just what I do, because that's who I am. And then somebody comes along and tells you you're actually a child of your Father and you're made out of the same fabric as God, and it doesn't make you equal with God, but it does mean that he has designed and designated you to be the home that he dwells in. And as that home that he dwells in, when he comes and lives inside of you, which he has, he comes and lives inside of you, he brought with you, or with him, his righteousness and his holiness, his purity and his perfection, and he goes ahead and he decorates the house from the inside out. Now, if you believed that you're actually the righteousness of God, how would it affect the way you do life? Now, most people are trying to become something they already are through discipline rather than just resting in who Christ has made us to be and living from that place of rest. I'm preaching to the choir here because I don't think you guys do that. You carry the love of the Father. You carry the joy of the Lord. You carry the presence of God
upon you within. It's not just in this room. It's when I'm walking down the hall. It's in the green room. It's back here in the. It's everywhere. Where I sense the presence of God is when I meet you and I look in your eyes and I see the glory of God flowing out from you. And pretty soon, though, in seeing who I am, I start seeing that on everybody. I can't look at anybody. As a matter of fact, I tried to find a place where he isn't. I used to work really hard to try to find God. Now I'm beginning to discover he's a lot easier to find than I thought. Trying to find a place where God is not. Show me a place where Christ is not. And a lot of people, in a sense, live believing that they are the one place in all of the universe, in all of the cosmos, that is void of the presence of God. And the only reason they believe that is because we as a church have not presented to them a God who is good. We've preached something other than the gospel, because the gospel is good news. Times over the last 3 years, we've been just going out and talking, come up here and talk, and go to Supernatural Life Conference and other places where I've met some of you guys. As I begin to speak and preach the goodness of God, how that becomes a hinge point for a lot of people's issues. Because they've come to believe that God is not good, but I'm going to accept him anyway, because what alternative do I have? So their life, in a sense, is trying to do their best to appease a God they don't really fully believe in. And by believing in, let you unpackage that one. By believing in, I'm saying believing within, united with, that my heart and his heart beat together. Instead, they're trying to appease a God who's really fickle and incredibly moody and sometimes very, very angry with them. Because that's what they've been told. That's what they believe. The blindness. We started preaching 3 years ago in our church back in Austin this simple message, and that is this: you are one with God in Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit, period. And he did that, by the way. You can awaken to the reality of it, but he did that. We started preaching this in the first few Sundays. It was radical to people. People thought, what are the ramifications of this? I said, I don't know, but I'm so overtaken with my union with God in Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit, I can't seem to think any other way. It's defined how I see the scriptures. It's defined how I do life. It's defined, and we'll talk so much more about the goodness of God tonight. Just a few weeks ago, I was on a conference cruise down to the Bahamas, suffering it out for Jesus. It was a missions trip. That's what it was. It's a missions trip. We were sitting at the, sitting at a dining table that night with a whole bunch of people that I don't know. And one of them looks across and says, this message on the goodness of God and us being united with him in Christ, what has that produced in your church since you started speaking it? And I really thought about it. We really hadn't stopped to do any studies on this. I realized our church is about 30 years old now, 31 years old. And in the last 3 years, we haven't had a single divorce in our church. As a matter of fact, we've had reconciled marriages. We had one couple that split 16 years ago and got married, got remarried to each other. Never married anybody else, but they'd split and anger, and boom, come back together. And they're more in love now than ever and drunk in the presence all the time. It's a little weird. And we love it. But in the last, unprecedented in the church's 30-year history, we haven't had a divorce in the last 3 years. I can point you to a number of, here's an interesting one. I point you to a number of young people in the church that used to live an alternative lifestyle who don't now. As a matter of fact, I even done one of their one of our young men met a young lady, fell in love, and got married, and they're just absolutely enamored with each other. And people say, well, are you preaching against that? No. I haven't said a word about it in the last 3 years. All we've been telling people is who they are.
And if you'll just tell people who they are rather than focus on who they're not, let's say like this. If you will celebrate, when God shows you who somebody is, if you'll celebrate who they are without stumbling over who they're not, then you begin to watch every sub-identity fall off. Now, what are those sub-identities? I mean, we've talked a lot about this. Anything other than being in Christ, really, is a temporal identity. You know? Paul said it like this to the church, Galatian church. He says, there's no male or female, slave nor free, Jew nor Greek, all are one in Christ. In Colossians, he actually makes it even more radical than that. Paul's theology is advanced a little bit by the time he writes to the Colossians. He reads it like this. There's no Jew or Greek, slave or free man, barbarian or Scythian. An interesting thing is those were the most hated violent people groups of his day. They were the Al-Qaeda and ISIS of his day. And then he makes this statement. And it's a really, really tough statement to try to whittle away at theologically. You just got to take it as it is. He says, Christ is all and in all. I don't know what to do with that. I honestly, that paints a picture of a God that's better than I was ever told. So when he says there's no barbarian or Scythian, he's basically saying this. Guys, your nationality is not who you are, and your gender actually is not who you are. Any roles that you've played or any belief systems that have been handed down to you, none of those things are who you are. And he might as well have said, if he was standing in our day, the phrase would go like this. There's no ISIS. There's no Al-Qaeda. Christ, I don't know what to do that. That offends my mind. That tells me something not about necessarily, should we not witness to those people? No, it tells us how to witness to those people. We witness to people by displaying and tell them who they actually are. By revealing Christ. Because in the revelation of who he is, you get a revelation of who you are. See, I could have tried to figure out who my name is Bill. That's because my parents gave me that name. I accepted Christ, you know, at a very, very early age. I was so young, I don't even remember it. So I had to do it over and over again. I was just told that I accepted Christ. So to make sure that I did it at every altar call, right? All the time. You know what I'm talking about? You get saved every time they gave an altar call. It's like, you know, it could be for like, you know, pregnant female, you know, what other kind would there be, right? So, I mean, you know, I mean, where this altar call is only for pregnant Asians under 35. I would have been right next to you because I didn't want to miss out. I would have totally been like, yeah, or whatever. I'm there. I mean, that's the way I grew up. My mom just recently, she's been in our school now for a couple of years, and she's been so, I mean, she's 75 years old, grew up in a Nazarene pastor's house, just scared to death. So you come to Christ one of four ways. You come to Christ either through tradition, move of the Spirit, that is some revival service, or somebody witnesses to you personally and you feel this tug on your heart, or logic into the kingdom, or fear. My mom came to Christ really through all of them, but fear was the major motivating factor. And she just told me just the other day, she said, it's a really interesting story. She says, I used to wake up in the middle of the night, and she goes, I would run down the hall to see if my parents were still in their bed because I was scared the rapture had come and I had missed it. I told her something I had never said before, and that is, growing up, I did the same thing. And she began to cry. She was like, what did I tell you? What did we tell you? What was this God we were presenting to you that I thought I knew? She said, I remember one time I was over to, she says, my father's house, Wesleyan Methodist Nazarene minister. She was over his house, or over at some people's house having dinner one time. And she says, and there was a straight pin on a cabinet on a counter. She said, when I went to the restroom and I needed the straight pin to pin something, she said, I picked up this little straight pin, she says, and I pinned something on my clothes, and then I went out to the dinner. When I got home that night, I saw that straight pin and I realized I've just stolen something. And she says, I lay there all night fearful because I was afraid if I died, I was going to go to hell. She said, in the last 2 years, all of the fear has fallen off. And I've discovered, at the age of 75, been in church her whole life, that my father is good. Really good. And he's not looking for a reason to cross me off the will. That he is genuinely good.
and the fearless love. Scott, what you said this morning, I don't think you could preach in 90% of churches in this country, that you said the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, but if it doesn't lead you to love, you've missed it, because love can take you places fear can't. Jump in anytime, man.
just go.
Some of the identities, though, some of the false identities that we carry.
Everything you think you are, most of what you think you are is a lie. I mean, I'm just going to say it straight up, yeah? Because this is the kind of place you can do it. Most of what you think is a lie. You know, it comes from the knowledge of good and evil. The first lie that was spoken over you, the serpent, the father of lies, said what? You can be made in the likeness of God if you only. You can be like God if you only eat of the knowledge of good and evil. Well, I'm going to tell that story tonight in great detail. It's going to be fun. It's really important for you to know where you came from. Most of you don't know, seriously. You can be like God. But they already were like God. That was the first lie. And you've been suffering from that lie because you ate of the fruit of the knowledge of good and evil. So what has that placed in you? The need to be saved from that lie by everything you think you are. If I only lose a few pounds, if I only marry a wife, sorry, I cannot sit. If I only have this relationship, that relationship, if I only better myself this way, that way, if I only stop sinning, if I only, anything. And what did Yeshua come along and say? No, let that go. In other words, deny your false self, that part that you think is, that makes you who you are. Hold of no account, he used the word hate. Your wife, your husband, your relationships, hold them of no account unless you hate your mother, your father, your children. How many of you have children? How many of you want to hate them? How many of you want to follow Jesus? If you guys, I mean, Scott, you can unpack that for them later, but there is so much power in that teaching of Jesus. He was not fooling around. He was not kidding. You want to be free from the prisons that keep you enslaved to darkness? Do you want to or do you not? Do you want to rise into the awareness of yourself as the sons and the daughters of the Father? Do you want to walk on water? Do you want to move the mountains? Hate your wives. Gzz, gzz, right? Fry, back up. Follow Jesus. Is that better? Okay, then hate your wives. Oh, wait, can I do one without the other? And so that nobody quotes me like a Chris Valentin out of context, what I mean by hate your wives, oh, video master YouTube, is what Jesus said, unless you hold all of your relationships, including your children and your spouses, of no account, you will always look to them for your salvation, and when they fail you, you will feel crushed. So you don't actually love them. You're actually looking for something from them, like a drug. Does this make sense? In other words, do you love your wife? I will love you. I love my wife. I love my wife. But the moment she slips up and I feel dishonored, I feel what? Threatened. I feel threatened. I feel dishonored. I feel because I needed her to treat me a certain way in order for me to feel valuable, because, you see, my identity is in myself as a husband, a man, all of that. That is not who you are. So unless you put that aside, i.e. deny yourself, i.e. let that part of yourself go, i.e. take up your cross every day, you cannot follow me into this place he called the realm of the Father or the kingdom of heaven or his eternal presence, which is right now within you, among you, at hand in this room. Do you want to step into that realm? Do you want to fly? Do you want to be Superman? Do you want to walk on water? Let all of this go. Let your right. And then, having let go of its mastery over you, you will once again have dominion over it, and you will, for the first time, actually love your wife. So let this be said, you can only love your wife when you learn to hate her. Scott, you can unpack that later, yeah? Because there's way too much. I don't want to keep going on that thing. It's just so true. And if you guys aren't from this church and you want that unpacked, next Sunday, Scott's going to unpack it. Because it is so true. So this is true, and I'll let back Bill get ready to take over. You have to let go of all you think you are to see who you truly are. You cannot... Okay, back and forth, just let's try something. Just one statement, so we both like to whatever, right? So one statement, who are we in Christ? Just a few things.
You in Christ.
One, I one, you one, I one. Let's try it.
In Christ. That's who you are. In Christ.
And you in Christ, he in you. Now,
you are love.
You are love. You are righteousness. You are the righteousness. You already are the righteousness.
You are peace. Legit peace.
You are complete, which means you cannot be more complete than complete, which is another way of saying perfect.
Yeah.
Already.
You catch this. You. Many don't think they're complete. They might think they're becoming complete. Paul says, Colossians 2, 9 and 10, that in Christ the fullness of the Godhead dwells. Yeah. Right? And you, next verse, have been made complete in him. Past tense.
Before the foundation of the earth, the Lamb was slain, risen. Surely he wasn't dead for so long. And you in him, because you have risen. The old you has died, you know that. And you're still clinging to that by clinging to the old rugged cross, perhaps. But you have risen with Christ and are seated in him in heavenly realms, which is right here, by the way, right now. You just don't see it. That's your only problem. You're blind. It's the only problem you'll ever have, is not seeing who you are. As us, that's our only problem. Ever. Ever.
Anybody's heart's just kind of popping and exploding and going, yeah. You know what I'm talking about? When you begin to rest in this reality, suddenly things look completely different around you. Nobody can offend you. Why would you be offended by someone who is blind being blind? Why would you make fun of or put down a blind person for being blind? When a person operates out of a false identity, they do things that blind people do. And what it does to me now, I can just tell you personally, it awakens compassion. I get people on Facebook they'll rant against something I've said or whatever. And I just step back and I feel such compassion. Somebody wants to, cut me off in traffic. It feels such, it's strange. It's odd. Maybe they're in a hurry to go somewhere. I don't know. I'm in this place where I feel like
Things that used to create offense now create compassion. I don't know what that is. I can't understand that. I know this, that the fruit of the Spirit is love. And that as our lives become more awakened and aware of our authentic identity, your branches start getting weighed down with some really good fruit. And the people around you start feasting on that, and they become healthier. And it's not anything that you have done. You just become aware of what he has done. And in that place of awareness, you just do life. There's not a lot of strategy to living life as a child of your father. In my father's house, all I ever had to do was just remain under the influence of his voice. Surrender to the love of his embrace. And whenever I felt like I was a disappointment, let him grace me with his forgiveness. I love the story today that Scott recounted of the prodigal son. I think the story is horribly misnamed, though. We call it the prodigal son. Jesus never called it that. He never said, this is the story of the prodigal son. If you want an accurate view of what the story is, it's the story of the heart of the father. Because the son was never not a son. He just did as best as he could to remove himself from the father's influence. When he said, give me my inheritance now, do you understand that he was making the deepest insult that one person can make to another? Because you don't get an inheritance from your father until after your father does what? So the son is essentially saying to your father, I wish you were dead. Every father in here who has a son, if you imagine yourself in that place, how deep does that cut? And this father grants the son his inheritance because it's always been his. And he lets the son go, but the son never stops being a son, no matter who he thinks he is. When he finally comes to his senses and decides he does want to come home, he rehearses a repentance speech. You realize the repentance speech, the way that Jesus tells the story, the parable, he doesn't actually ever get to say it. You just get a picture inside of his head as he says, ah, this is my plan. When I come to the Father, this is what I will say. I am not worthy to be called your son. Just make me a servant, but let me back in the house. And he's got his prepared repentance speech. And when he comes up over the hill, the father tackles him and kisses him. It's an amazing picture. Just tackles him on the ground, falls on his neck and kisses him. This, my son. But we have no record that the son ever actually got to say anything. I love how Jesus puts that in there. Thought of what to say in order to somehow reveal his heart of brokenness to the father. And his intention apparently was more than enough. The father didn't need anything but just to see the son come over the hill. I think that if there's any work, and we're going to talk a little bit, let's talk a little bit about practices that we have personally that come from this place. But if there's any work, in a sense, to be done in working out our salvation, it's in surrendering to the Father's embrace. Let as you are, not as you think you should be. Let me say that again. Let him embrace you as you are and not as you think you should be. Let him whisper in your ear, you're a good son. You're a good daughter. I've never stopped loving you. You can't even begin to imagine how much I love you, but I dare you to try. I dare you to try. You understand that it is impossible for you as a created being, created by your Father, it's impossible for you to imagine the love of God to be bigger than it is. It's impossible for you to imagine God to be better than he actually is. We're going to unpackage that tonight. From these places of, in a sense, just realization. I mean, goodness, we hug strangers in airports because they're children of their father. You know, we hug taxi drivers or people out on the street who just, you understand the concept of being widowed and orphaned. Pure and undefiled religion, Scripture says, is to take care of the widows and orphans and their affliction. Absolutely, anybody who's ever been in that position in this world of form, we care for them because it demonstrates the heart of the Father. But do you understand that the concept of being widowed and orphaned is far more a spiritual condition than it is a physical one? Because what is being orphaned? Being orphaned is that you've been left, you've been abandoned. Being widowed is what? You've lost the love of your life. You've been severed from love. The idea still might exist, but the person to whom it was attached is no longer with you. And there's been a separation. Both being a widow and being an orphan is a spiritual condition of a revelation of distance and separation. Matter of fact, there's a lot of people, maybe even sitting in this room, who are widows and orphans, but you're fully married and you have kids and you have parents and those relationships are intact, but spiritually you felt distant and separated and estranged from your Father. And I'm telling you, you are loved right now. No matter what your repentance speech is, you can't impress him. He decided to embrace you long before you ever had the chance to impress or disappoint him. Now, if you can see yourself that way, begin there. It's a good place to begin. Does this world no good if you can see others, love others as Christ loved, but hate yourself? Because the spirit you carry as a son, as a daughter of your Father, being in Christ, is that's the very thing that becomes attractive to people who are orphaned and widowed in their heart. If you can't see it for yourself, then you're going to search for something. You're going to search for the right message and the right methodology. And if I just say these four things, if I just quote Romans in this order and have them pray this prayer with me, then they'll get in, as opposed to being the living, breathing door of invitation to the heart of love himself. I mean, is it possible to stand in front of somebody and say, you know, I recognize that maybe when you look at me, you just see me, but this much I know, and that is Jesus lives in me. That the Father is fully in Christ, that the Holy Spirit is fully in Christ, and Christ is fully in me, meaning that I'm close to God in the most literal sense of the word. And so now, as I embrace you, I know who I am. And if I embrace you from my identity in him, I think spiritually something happens in the spirit that sets people free. Otherwise, we end up judging one another. Judgment, by the Old Testament word for judgment, is the word keresis. It's where we get the word crisis, or it also translated in a couple of spots as choosing. It's a choice. It's a choosing that you make. Jesus said of his choice of you, his judgment of you and I, you did not choose me, I have chosen you. My choice is for you. If God be for us, who can be against us? The revelation that God is for you actually makes it impossible for anyone to be against you, for no one can be your enemy without your permission. People say, Bill, are there people against you? Well, there are people who think they are, but I am for them. How can you do meetings with this person? Don't you know what they believe? Don't you know what they have done? What they believe and what they have done is secondary to what he believes and what he has done. Because of what he believes and what he has done, I see who they are. I'm telling you, this is a revolution. I understand. This is a trippy way of thinking. We're out to dinner one night with Ted and his wife, Leanne, who is just amazing, amazing. And Tracy and I are sitting there across from, and Leanne's like, you know, okay, let me challenge you, Bill. Think of the person in this world that you have the most difficulty with. Well, that didn't take long, actually. A person's name came to mind. This has been a while ago. Not too long, but a while. Person's name came to mind. Name, face, and everything. And she looks across and says, you got it? I said, yeah.
She goes, they are you, and you are them.
What?
Wasn't that right? I mean, if they're in Christ and you're in Christ, aren't you one? Because Christ is not divided.
Yeah, but...
I'll tell you something interesting about that day. I walked away from that meal and it changed the way that I saw the person. Because in my perspective of myself, I was manifesting union, but in my perspective of someone else, I was manifesting distance and separation. Because I cut them off from me. The next time I saw that person, and Tracy knows this to be true, I walked up and I hugged that person and I felt a genuine love in my heart. And I thought, oh, that's odd. I felt a compassion. When I looked at the person, all of a sudden, they just didn't look the same. When the scripture says in the New Testament, don't judge, why? Because you're judging yourself. Well, you can, but you're going to find that you're actually judging yourself. Why is it more blessed to give than to receive? Because when you give, you're actually giving to yourself. You can't give without receiving. Because they are you and you are them. Well, I don't understand. What do you mean, Bill? That sounds so new agey. It doesn't have to. It's okay. Understand what I'm saying? God is fully complete and he's fully, let's say he's within you. Gentleman sitting right down here in the front. He's right there within you. The presence of God, fully, completely. He didn't just show up and impart. He didn't give you, okay, we can allocate 2%. 2%. That's it. That's all he gets, 2%. 98% we're withholding until we see he's worthy. Because, no, Christ is never divided. He's fully within you, but he's also fully within me. This much I know. Yet we're sitting here in separate places. Or are we? Are we? The Bible talks about the temporal things. That is this thing, this world of form, this costume and everything that... These temporal things are passing away. It says that the things that are seen are temporal. The things that are unseen are eternal. Which tells us this, that the unseen realm, the realm of the spirit, the dimension of spirit, is far more valuable and far more real than this dimension that we are in right now, this world of form, the disease that you carry, the difficulties that... plague you, the anxieties that plague your mind, the identities that people have attached to you. All of those things are temporal illusions that one day give way to the reality that you and I are actually closer than we thought. I don't fully get, I don't fully understand, I don't fully comprehend this, but I know that this much is true, that within this world of form, as long as there's distance and separation manifest between us, this world will not know who he is. John 17, verse 22, Jesus says, Father, the glory that you have given to me, I give to them, that they may be one, even as we are one. I in you, he defines it. I love this. I in you, you in me, and I in them. Here's the hinge point. That the world may know that you sent me. This world is blind to who he is because we have been blind to who we are. And our blindness is manifest in the division between one another. Why forgiveness is such a big deal? Because you're forgiving someone else, you're forgiving yourself. When you're pouring grace upon someone else, you're pouring it upon yourself. Because we are one. Now, what? I know some of you are like, wow, okay, whoa, is this trippy? I'm just sort of floating around. My head's like tripping right now. Stop for a second. What would happen in this world if we actually believed this was true? What if we believed this was true?
So, a lot of you guys are confused. I can see that. I mean, this stuff comes like bullets from a machine gun, but you're not getting into the story of it. I can see that.
I think they're confused now. Wait till tonight.
No, tonight it'll be different. This is a lot of stuff at you fast. So take a deep breath. Know this, you will experience in this life what you believe about yourself. Okay? So the experience you're having in your life right now, let's say you have a difficult relationship right now, a trouble in your relationship. Let's say you have fear of something that's going to happen tomorrow. Let's say that you are having a difficult time right now getting a job. You're anxious about tomorrow. Let's say that you are struggling with something that happened in your past. Maybe when you were younger, you were raped or abused or wounded and hurt in some way, and it's coming back to haunt you. Let's say you have difficulty sleeping at night, right? You can't sleep because you're too worried, and you have a spouse who bothers you a lot, doesn't think you're beautiful, doesn't think you make enough money. Let's say that's you. Let's say you're a teenager and you're 17, you're about to graduate, and you have no clue what you're going to do next, and the weight of the world is on your shoulders, and you are scared. What if you think you're not good enough? You can never measure up to what your father asks of you. God is disappointed in you. The only reason why you feel any of these things is because you do not know who you are. So everything Bill has just said points directly to that, but it's so counterintuitive to our brain, the way of Yeshua, who is the way, the truth, and the life. It's so opposite our way of thinking that we cannot wrap our brain around it, and so we remain in a kind of suffering. You understand? All the things you think about yourself that are not so hot, not so good, they're only that way because you give them that power. Now, I know that sounds so... If you believe in Jesus, you will be saved. If you believe in the name of Jesus, and you will be saved from what? From the storms that are rising against you in this life right now. You will find peace in those. If you believe in the name of Jesus, if you believe in the name of Jesus, this is the good news. You will be saved. You can find peace from cancer, an ugly husband, the fear you have of your future, not measuring up to what your spouse wants you, not having a suitable partner to give you completion. All these fears you have, they can all be washed away if you believe in the name of Jesus. And if you believe and ask in his name, anything you ask will be done. Here's the problem. We do not believe in the name of Jesus. Or you would be saved. Not in the next life only, for that we're eternally grateful, but in this life, his teachings were all as well. We're not asking everything. We use his name all the time and we don't get it because we're not asking in his name. So, what do you mean, Ted? To believe in the name of Jesus means to place your identity in his identity. Name, in that culture, only meant identity, inheritance. It meant this. So when the Father glorified his name by breathing his nature into man, he was creating man in his likeness. He was glorifying his likeness into him. When you believe in the name of Jesus, you are placing your identity in his identity. And when you place your identity in his identity, you become one with him. He in you and you in him. And as, so it's like this. Last night I was sitting here during time of worship, and this phrase kept coming to me over and over and over again. And it's strange, you know, because it was like a drumbeat just flooding my spirit, my soul, over and over and over again. And I already knew this truth, but it was infecting me on a much deeper level. Yesterday morning, one of the top leaders of the Assembly of God, who I'm a friend with, texted me and says, Ted, I have a word for you as you go to New York, and it's this. When you see the color purple, you will know what the Father is speaking to you in that moment is true. Because you are royal. I thought, well, that's kind of strange. I'm not part of this whole, you know, I don't go to Bill's church where they do all these things, or this church where they do all these, whatever these things are. I'm actually not part of that whole, is it called revival culture? I'm just a son learning who his father is, and I'll tell you my story tonight. But this sounded fascinating to me. And so I said, okay, I'll look for the color purple. Yeah, okay. So, and I'm learning to walk in faith in a new way. It's very beautiful. It means letting go of everything I think so that I can know him. And I thought, okay, last night I'm over there during worship. Well, brothers and sister, brother. It's always, yeah. But anyway, they were singing. And this thing keeps going to me. And then I turn after worship and I turn over and Hannah's sitting there. And Hannah immediately asks me after, she said, I want to know what you were doing. She must have seen something. I don't know what. Maybe God told her to ask. I don't know what. Or maybe. And I said, and I told her. And she said, yeah. That is so true. I said, it's the only thing we ever need to know. And she said, yeah. And then I noticed, oh my God, she's wearing purple. I mean, seriously, I'm like, and, you know, the light, the orange light was on her. There's a sweater. And she was like glowing purple. I was like, so I went home and I immediately texted Heath, who runs all the youth. Anyway, he's the top AG guy for the international, the youth side of things. And I told him, oh, you wouldn't believe what happened. You know what? You know what I was thinking through my mind? All could not get out of my mind. It's simply this. Write it down if you can, or just inscribe it in your brain or whatever. To believe in Jesus means to believe like Jesus believed. And to believe like Jesus means to believe as Jesus. Because you are in him and he is in you. So in that moment, in worship, I was to, it's not just believing in Jesus, because Jesus is in me and I in him. You know what that means, to be in something in them and you, right? Does that make any sense to any of you? What does that mean? It should confuse you, by the way, so if you think you get it. What does it mean to be in something and them and you at the same time? Okay, so I have a bowl here, and there's milk in it. How can the milk be in the bowl, but the bowl be in milk at the same time? How is that possible? Can anybody tell me how that's possible? Any quantum physicists here? Because it is possible in quantum theory. I'm serious. What does it mean? They're one. They're the same thing. Or at least the same substance. Right? Now it makes sense that you died with him, as Paul said. You died with Christ, rose with him. Why? He and you, you and him, you see. Suddenly, we begin to see who we are as the sons and daughters of the Father restored into his likeness. Suddenly, we begin, and as we begin to believe in him, place our identity in him and his identity in us, we begin to actually look at the world, and I know this is true, and we begin to see it as he saw it. And we begin to see it as we saw it. We begin to believe like Jesus. When we pray to our Father, we're praying the way he prayed to his Father, because that's how he prayed in John 17. The glory you gave me, I have given them. The same glory. In the same way he is in the Father and the Father is in him. In that same way, you are in him and he is in you. How is Jesus with the Father? Are they not one? Is the Trinity not three but one? You and Jesus are two but one. In the same way, the Trinity is two but one. So now, who are you? identify with that. And then look at your struggling relationship. And then look at your cancer. You take your identity away from that and place it in who you truly are as the son, as the daughter of God. And suddenly those things, those waves, they don't seem so, they're just that. And now Jesus' teaching makes sense. Why are you afraid in the storm, you silly little boys? The disciples were all boys. Why are you a little faith? Are you afraid when it's just a storm? It's not who you are. So the question becomes, this is your only trouble in all of life. And when you walk out of this building, you must come back tonight because you must hear this again in a different way. Mm-hmm. Because you'll forget it as soon. In fact, half of you don't even get it yet. Seriously. Dead serious. Must come back. Mm-hmm. And then come back and hear Scott. It doesn't matter. It's counterintuitive. So this is why the church is not walking on water, because they don't get it yet. But neither do I. I'm just like you. We're just awakening to this. It's a new movement, a massive one. It's coming out of 2,000 years of darkness, of slavery. And so then here comes the question. How then do I go about hanging on to? What's the practice that I might use to hold on to this truth? And that is working out your salvation in fear and troubling. Working out your salvation, you know, is not getting it. It is actually working it out. It's doing the work. What work are you doing to abide in the vine hour by hour by hour? It will be fearful, and it will also fill you with awe and trembling.
To preface this, I need to tell you a story. I got William Seymour. This is a great place for this. How many of you know the name William Seymour? Okay. Yeah. Oh, wow, a handful of... Okay. This is a person in history you've got to know. William Seymour is the character who basically is responsible for the reason that you're sitting in here today. He brought the gift of the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in tongues, actually, to America. He was actually from Kansas. He wasn't from another country. Amazing, amazing anointed black man from Kansas who read in Acts chapter 2 that you could actually be filled with the Holy Spirit and speak in tongues. I mean, he reads this, and then he reads it throughout the course of the New Testament, and he believes it. The problem is, it's in 1906, February of 1906, William Seymour has actually never spoken in tongues. He just sees it, and while people around him are trying to dismiss it out of the way, another local pastor by the name of Charles Parham says, hey, yeah, I believe this too. This is true. And Parham had seen some cool stuff in his meetings. Well, Seymour gets this revelation, and he gets an invite down to Los Angeles to go speak in a church and to bring this revelation to this church because they were looking for something new. They were hungry. But he'd actually never spoken in tongues and knew nothing of the baptism in the Holy Spirit other than what he read in the scriptures. And something just sticks in his heart, and he goes, this is true. I mean, like a pit bull on a stake, he wouldn't let this thing go, even though he'd never had any experience with this revelation. Sometimes it's revelation that brings experience. Sometimes experience brings a revelation. Sometimes you get the revelation, even though you have no experience for it, you go, I just know this is truth, and I'm going to go after this. And so, so Seymour goes to Los Angeles, and he spends 2 weeks preaching a revival meeting in this church where every night he talks about the filling of the Holy Spirit and the gift of tongues. Every night for 2 weeks, and every night nobody gets filled, nobody speaks in tongues. And after 2 weeks of this, the pastor says, Seymour, take you and, quote-unquote, your appalling doctrine, and you're done. Shuts the revival down, and Seymour leaves. And he's on his way back to Kansas, and this couple, the Asburys, invite him to come over to their home and continue to teach because there's something that's burning in them. What he has said is truth. Even though we have no evidence to back this up, we can't dismiss it out of the scriptures. What do we do with this? Everybody else was saying it's not for today. Clearly it's not, otherwise it would be happening. But Seymour cannot let go of this thing. And so every night, to a small group of people, he preaches in the Asburys' living room. Till April 9th, 1906. On April 9th, a guy named Edward Lee gets it.
start speaking in tongues. Others around the room start getting it, and the Holy Spirit fills the place. 3 days later, William Seymour got it. Work the timeline with me. February, March, April. Every night, this guy got a revelation that he did not have experience for, and he releases it anyway because he can't erase it out of the book. And God has stirred it in and says, this is truth and it's for now. How much ridicule and how many hurdles of offense do you have to go over to grab hold of a truth that you have no experience for and to continue to preach it as though it's true night after night, even though your revival gets shut down, nobody around you is verifying this, and then one night, boom, a couple of months later, months he's preaching this thing, finally the Holy Spirit falls, boom, people start speaking in tongues. Just a few nights later, so many people crowd into the Asbury's home that they surround the yard, they pile up on the porch collapses, does major damage to the house, and then they realize we have to move this thing, and they move over to Azusa Street. That is the reason you're sitting here today, because one guy from Kansas saw something that everybody knew, but nobody saw.
So what's the revelation for us today in that? What is being seen today that we haven't yet fully walked into as a church? It's okay. It's coming. It's here. What is that, Bill?
We'll talk about that more tonight, I think. But I think
that it is this revelation, is it not? Our unity with the Father.
Our union with the Father. We'll get into that more, I think, tonight. But whether you have experience to back this up or not, I'm telling you, once you see this, you can't unsee it. This is the problem with revelation. So once you taste it, you can't untaste it. It's this. Let's do some activation. You guys want to do some fun stuff? Let's play a little bit. You guys have. Since you mentioned Hannah, let's borrow Hannah. And what do we got with? And you guys, you got to meet my wife Tracy if you haven't met her yet. She's amazing. Tracy, come on up. And where's the students around here, ministry team folks? Sean, go ahead and bring them on up here. We're going to have the ministry team folks and Hannah and Tracy. Let's have you guys with the ministry team folks all stand right down here across the front, in front of the stage, just all in a line facing that way. Yeah, hang on to it. Go ahead. When you get a revelation of something and you start dreaming on it and dwelling upon it, go ahead and spread the line all the way across the front so there's room for those guys to get in. When you start dreaming on it and dwelling on this thing, you'll be surprised what can happen. You start dreaming of raising the dead and eventually you do it. You start dreaming of walking on water and eventually you do it. I told you, when I was here last time, I told you guys this story, but I can tell you, especially this is fun now because she's here. I was at home one night, I'm sitting on the edge of my bed, I'm waiting to go teach, and I'm dreaming, I'm thinking in my mind about God creating the universe just by speaking, turning on the lights of the universe, just let there be light, and I'm picturing myself just sort of hanging out in space, and I'm going like this, and I'm doing this, galaxies are just flinging off my fingertips. You know, it's like there's more galaxies out there, 400 billion galaxies that we know about right now that are just kind of floating around out there. You know, you're just thinking, wow. I mean, somebody has been doing a lot of cool creating. I mean, it's just incredible, just boom, just flinging galaxies and planets off your fingertips. I mean, just I'm having this childlike, playful thought. But it's very vivid. It's almost like a daydream, like it's vision. It's very cool. And I've got my eyes closed. I'm sitting on the edge of the bed, and I hear the door open, and I'm assuming it's Tracy. I've got my Bible open on my lap, and I hear her walk in front of me and walk over to the bathroom and open the door, walk over to the closet and open the door and walk out. But I don't open my eyes. I'm just sitting there on the edge of the bed. And I thought, that was odd. And I come to the end of my time of meditation and prayer or whatever. And I open my eyes, and she comes walking back in and goes, when did you come in here? I don't know, I've been in here for like 20 minutes, just sitting here praying, getting ready for class tonight. She goes, you didn't hear me call? I said, never heard your voice, no. Because I guess in space you can't hear anything. Anyway, just thought of that. So So she said, well, I came in and I walked in. I thought, well, maybe, you know, he's over here, or maybe he's in the bathroom, or maybe he's in the closet. She goes, Bill, have you moved? I said, no, I've been sitting here the whole time. She says, I walked in this room. We don't have a big bedroom. She goes, I walked in this room. You were not there. And she was yelling for me. She goes, you weren't there. This got me thinking, Scott, has this happened before? Because I would have just walked out and gone and taught class. If she had not walked in the room and seen me not there, then I would have not known I was not there. Seen me not there. If she hadn't told me I wasn't there, I would not have known I wasn't there. Which gets me to this. Pay attention to what you meditate on. In the presence of God, pay close attention to what you meditate on. Because as you awaken to who you really are, the things that you meditate on will begin to manifest around you. Which is why some of you are getting healed in this room right now, because of what we've been meditating on up here on this stage. And what you've been meditating on in your heart, as our hearts have been connecting together. Okay, everybody that's up here, I want you guys to look out. And normally I'd have you guys go out and pick some people, but today we're going to just let you guys play because, come on, this will be fun. Okay, I want you guys to look across this room. I want you to let somebody stand out to you. I don't know how that happens, but pick one person. One person. When somebody stands out to you, I want you to ask God what he says about them and what he believes about them. And I know that this could go on forever because the thoughts that God has about you outnumber the sand, right? So we're going to try to keep this down to just a couple of words or sentences apiece. How many in the front up here already have somebody picked out? Cool. I want you to see how quick this is to do, how easy this is to do. Every person in this room, by the way, can do this, right? Practice this on your waitress at the restaurant, person behind the counter. Just ask yourself this question, God, what do you believe about this person? Practice this upon your worst enemy. I dare you. All right, Hannah, you want to kick it off? Go for it.
So God highlighted that black butter right there.
Okay.
In the plaid shirt.
When they point you guys out, by the way, if you would just help us out during this exercise and just stand right at your seat, it's all you have to do, just that way we can see who they're talking to. Go ahead, Hannah.
God wanted to let you know that he loves you and that he is very, very proud of you. And he sees you as a giant in the land and that he's called you to slay giants. So walk in boldness and without fear because he's got so much in store for you.
Come on, beautiful. Stay standing just a second. Okay, when you get a word, I'm going to challenge all of you guys up front to do this. When you get a word, I want you to try to turn it at some point in time during the word, turn it into a declaration, right? And that is to take and basically take the word that you're getting, and rather than just give them a revelation of information, turn it into a declaration and establish it. So maybe beginning, it doesn't have to be a formula, but beginning with the words like I decree, declare, release, declare, decree, pick word you want. I want you to say that again and speak it with that, from that vantage point.
So I just declare over you that you are a giant slayer in the land and that there is no weapon or enemy that has been formed against you that shall be able to stand or prosper. And that every enemy has to flee before your presence.
So you hear the difference? On one hand, you're unveiling some revelation that's informative. On the other hand, you're unveiling revelation with a conviction that this is what God actually believes. And you're taking a stand as if God was literally standing there, Jesus speaking through you to declare and establish something in a person's life. Do you feel how that shifts the atmosphere? Things awesome, awesome. Cool. I tell you what, pass the microphone that way, and then we'll kind of bounce back and forth. Actually, let's do this so that everybody can see everybody who's speaking. Let's have you come to the center and switch places with Hannah and Tracy. You'll go next.
I saw Dennis. Dennis, I declare to you The Lord sees you. He loves you very much, by the way, very, very much. I'm kind of jealous of it. He sees you as a front warrior. He's your protection. You have thousands of angels backing you up, brother, so just go for it.
And I think, is that Don French back there? Hi, you know, yeah. You just have such an incredible smile and a gift to carry the Father's heart and release his heart. And I just want to acknowledge you and honor you today. And yeah, thank you, Lord, that a smile unlocks hearts and releases your heart to others. Thank you, Lord. And I had two, sorry. I know you said one, but it was like immediate. You popped, and then this young man right here in the gray shirt. Yeah, can you stand? Yeah, I see dreams, like these incredible dreams that you have and visions that you see of yourself, things that you desire to do, and getting the sense that sometimes maybe you doubt those things. I think we all do that. And but God is saying yes to your dreams. And so I just declare over you today just a supernatural belief, a supernatural faith. And what he's put in your heart to do, and he says you are a good son, and he's placed those things in your heart, and so you go for it.
Funny thing is, I got you too, so you could stand right back up. Getting twice means God really loves you. When you were sitting down, I only saw the FedEx part of your shirt, and in FedEx, you can see an arrow pointing. And then when you stood up, I saw the C, and every time I see that C, I think of champion, and I really feel like God is pushing you forward to lift up champions, and maybe it goes with the dreams that I have no idea what they are, but just to keep pushing forward and remember God is with you and that you're one with God, you're one with Jesus, and that... Just keep pushing forward, and you're going to see some great things and some champions rise up after you and with you.
Okay, I've seen you in the green sweatshirt standing like in front of me. Yeah. You. I said maybe it's not green. All right, so you just stuck out to me, but God wants you to know that you are perfectly beautiful, and you have this key to unlock. You have this key to unlock things that people are going through, and they don't even realize that they're going through, like hurts and stuff like that. And you just have a key that you're going to be able to give them so they can be free.
I just have something, beautiful ladies in the front, if you want to stand up. Are you guys related at all? Friends? I just, every time I looked at you, I feel like there's this absolute wonder in your eyes that really just took me back to like being 5 years old in the woods just playing with the Lord. And I just feel like there's this wonder about you and this freedom that you bring. And I think you're an atmosphere changer. And I really feel you setting women free. And I feel like you hold that relationship of what it means to be a daughter of a wonderful, beautiful God. And I just feel like that's something you carry and you're going to release wherever you are. And with you, ma'am, I really felt from the Lord like there's some promises that he's put in you that you haven't seen fulfilled. And I think what I heard over you is like how David prepared for Solomon. He prepared the resources. I feel like the promises that you haven't seen yet are for the next generation coming after you. But I feel like there's going to be a new joy released in you because the burden of it is going to be lifted because you're going to begin to see it released in the next generation.
Matt, I got you. I just saw just like an extraordinary faith around you, just a faith that can't be shaken, a faith that you won't question, that there's just a knowing of God in you, and a relationship that you've begun to step into, and I'm beginning to just recognize more that you'll begin to recognize God in the things that you thought God was never there. And I see the gift of exhortation over your life. You're gonna be really big and just letting people know who they are, and encouraging people into the truth of identity that they have in Christ. And and as you do that, you're going to begin to see more of who you are, because everything that everyone else is what you are too, as we all have the same identity in Christ.
So I saw the young woman back there. I don't know what color you're wearing, like dark color. Yeah, you, yep. So I just see the Lord all over you. And I feel like he's bringing you into like a new community right now. And he's putting you in a position that you don't feel qualified for. But he says, don't worry about it, because it's not about you. It's about me. And I feel like there's something with this message today and tonight. So hopefully you can come then too. That's been unlocked inside of you. So I just declare that over you, that there's an unlocking that you're going to release in this time now. So yeah.
Caitlin, the Lord highlighted you to me, so if you could stand up. And I just feel like God is declaring, he says you have a tenaciousness about you, that when others grow weary and they give up, you are still standing on the line, and you still have a joy in your heart that you know it's going to come through. I feel like God's saying you have faith. You have a strong faith that enables you to stand when others fall. And I feel like something about your voice, I feel like God's saying your voice as you speak to people, it breaks off the chains in their life, that he wants to release your voice to share what he's putting in your heart, because when you do, you will release the captives and the prisoners from their bondage that they're being held in.
You might as well stay standing, because I got you too. And he just wants you to know how much he absolutely adores you, and there's just a preciousness about you, and whatever you're believing for, he is going to bring it through to completion. I also got that you're a mighty woman of valor. Wherever you walk into, you change atmosphere. Which what she was praying, he's saying it again to you. You're a mighty woman of valor.
Yeah, I picked the girl over there in the green sweatshirt that she stood up a little earlier. I don't know what her name is. Yeah. But I feel like that you don't think you have something, and you've been kind of quiet. But God says you have a lot to say, and you're going to have a lot to say to others, to encourage others to be who they are. So don't think that you're not seen, because he sees you, and he says you're awesome. So continue to just rise up. Don't be afraid. But just walk in that direction.
Yeah. I got this lovely lady here in the teal sweater. Mm-hmm. And I got this the word freedom, and that you've had a taste of this divine freedom, but that you're afraid to fully step over the threshold into it because it's unfamiliar territory to you. He's telling you, just take that step and I'll guide it all the way, that you don't have anything to be afraid of. You're his prized possession. He's waiting for you. And you're going to fly. Once you make up your mortal mind to step over that threshold, your wings are going to open and you're going to take off, and you're going to see things that you've never thought possible. And colors are going to be brighter. The sun is going to be more golden, and it's going to be unimaginable. And for the gentleman that's sitting next to you, are you guys married? Yeah? You guys are a team. And when you fly, he's going to fly. And he's going to stay right next to you. You're going to be holding hands all the way. And the life and the promises that he has given to you are going to just, it's just going to be continual once you take that step over that threshold.
He says, so I declare freedom and boldness over you. I declare divine health and protection, Lord, so that as they take this new step and as she crosses that threshold, Lord, she has no doubt that you're right there with her. Jesus. Amen. Yeah.
Here. You again. I heard the Lord say, yeah, double for your trouble, double blessing. I heard the Lord say that you have a treasure chest inside you, and he has placed you where he wants you, and he is going to begin to uncover the treasures, and it's going to help the community. It's going to help your church. It's going to help your community. So I declare over you an understanding of the treasure chest, the opening up of the visions and the dreams of things that you thought once were buried to be uncovered, because those are the things that are going to transform your city. Also, Randy, I got something for you. What I heard was there's a heritage through you connected to the Indians, and that you are a mighty warrior, and that God, through you and your heritage, is going to raise up an army. So I declare over you, got to go to that next step. So I declare over you the rising up, mighty warrior, and that God would release the army for the land. There's something about the Indians and the land, and that's connected to you, and I release that over you in Jesus' name.
Next to Sarah in the pink vest. Yeah. What's her name? Leslie. Okay. So Leslie, God is showing me that you have been really faithful and dedicated, and he calls you steadfast. I'm sorry, I cry all the time. He's honored that you would, through your life, stay as faithful as you have to him. So I declare strength and boldness and new faithfulness. Something that's a small tree just to grow and flourish. That the leaves would branch out and more of God's sunlight will nourish you in that, in your growing faithfulness and boldness in him.
Mine's really short, but it's for this guy in the army sweatshirt right there. And basically, I just feel like God, you know, saying that, you know, he desires for you to get to know him more and more, and to have a deeper relationship with him. And that as a result of that, that you're going to get deeper with him, that you'll become a stronger, bolder person.
I'm next to Dennis in the plaid shirt. What's your name? Derek? Okay. Your time of mourning and desolation is over. And I don't know where you're at with this, but he was saying it's time to learn how to be bride of the bridegroom, because he wants to be a lover of you, because he wants to birth something through you. The first step is being a bride to the bridegroom and learning how to be intimate with him, to be impregnated and birth what he wants to do. So I declare in the name of Jesus, a man who's man enough to be a bride, and a man who's man enough to be a lover of you, who's willing to say, I am your lover and you are my lover. I am your beloved and you are mine. Willing to be intimate with you, Father, so that he could be close to your heart and he could know what your heart is and impart your heart into the world. In Jesus' name.
Wow, man. So
I got to the young lady right there with the, is it a purple? Oh, yeah. Hi. So I was on that end, and I got a picture of, like, the plant lavender, and God was just illuminating to me, like, how plants, how flowers are always open to the sunshine, and they actually release, like, a sweet fragrance, and God is just saying thank you. He wants to say thank you for keeping your eyes on him, and just keeping your focus on him, because it's a sweet fragrance where people walk by you, and then they can just smell that on you, and I heard this song. I don't know if you know it, but it's May We Never Lose the Wonder, Wide-Eyed and Mystified. May we be just like a child standing at the beauty of our King. And I feel like because you're wearing, I mean, purple, that's been the color of the day, but you're clothed in royalty. So right now I just declare that royalty is just in your blood, and that you're a kingdom woman, that you are called into this nation, that you are called into the lives of the people that you experience and encounter, and that you're called to bring them up from who they were into who they are in Christ. And I just declare that over you, the blood of Jesus is on you, and that you are called to bring fire wherever you walk, and the fragrance of your praises and the fragrance of your voice to the kingdom of God is a joyful noise like a loud sounding trumpet. You are so beautiful.
Well, I don't know if this is working. Yeah, I was getting the girl in the denim shirt. Thanks. And I was just hearing the words special and beloved, and I was like, God, I don't want to tell her something that generic, but Then it came to me that special is not generic. It's the exact opposite, and you're very special to him. He wants you to know how special you are.
I got Mrs. Sharp Faith. Hi, okay. I just heard the words exceptional love, like just like love, like ridiculous love, like crazy love. And it was in the sense of, like, as a mother, mothers worry, and I'm not a mother, but I know I've worried my mother, so I'm sure I'm sure mothers worry. I think that's something they do. But worry about, like, are the decisions I'm making, you know, did I do this right, or, you know, and so he wanted to let you know the decisions you make, you're making them out of love, so there's no, like, the way you love, you're making your decisions based off of love, not out of personal gain or things like that. Just he wanted me to highlight to you that he sees, and we see, your exceptional love, like the way you love, and you have no worry. As long as you're making those decisions for your family out of that love, there is no worry. There's nothing to worry about. So I just like to break down any fear or any lies from the enemy, or anything that would have you feel as though you're moving or operating outside of something that isn't love, and he sees your love and your exceptional love. So that's fine.
Faith, you need to keep standing, because I got you too. I think the first thing that came to my mind was a great mother, which if anyone knows you, knows that you are. But I just felt like God wanted to remind you that you're more than that, and that you're also a very wise woman, and you're a great friend. And I think sometimes you feel like you don't have more to offer people, but you have so much to offer, you know, just women and friends alike. So I just want to declare identity in you, and to know that who you are in him, and that you're not just a wonderful mother, but you're also a wonderful friend.
Erica, is that your daughter next to you? Okay, hi. God just pointed you out to me, and the word that I heard him speak over you was free. He sees you as free. He doesn't want you to be careful not to build walls. And he just declares that anything that's holding you back, or any chains that's broken off of you, there are certain things right now that you're growing in, or you enjoy, or, like, I don't know, hobbies or whatever, and he wants you to run with those, and that, like, the seeds that are being planted in your life right now, to have freedom to just let them grow up into whatever they're going to be.
So I've got one more.
Young man way in the back with the plaid shirt. Yeah, right there. You're standing up. The Lord says that he sees you and he's calling you out as a mighty man of God. He's calling you to spend time in a secret place because the things that he wants to release through your life are far beyond what you can imagine or dream. So he says, dream bigger, imagine larger. You're not thinking high enough and large enough because there is so much that he wants to release out of you. You have an inheritance that has come down from your grandparents and your great-grandparents and your father and your mother. And he says, he's taking that and he's giving it to you and he's going beyond that. And it's because of what they have passed down to you and the heart that you have inside of you. So he's saying, I love you, I see you, I know you, you're mine, and you have been chosen. So press into me, my beloved.
Everyone, I want everyone to stand here. You guys stay where you are up front here, but everyone else stand. And I want you to put your hands over your heart and prophesy over yourselves as I release this over you. Just repeat in your own mind what I say. Speak it to yourself, and remember this. In this moment, Christ in you is speaking to you as you. Okay? Do you get it? Come back tonight. Christ in you is speaking to you as you. Okay? I declare to you that you are the son, you are the daughter of God. There is nothing you can do to disappoint your father. It is impossible. When you stumble like a little child, he will lift you up and say, try again. And he will smile. Nothing can hurt you in this life. As the son, as the daughter of the father, only that which you think has hurt you, but it has not. You are here for a short time only. In this physical body, and soon you will be face to face with him, and all this will be so much clearer. Now your journey is to see as he sees who you are. See as your father sees you, as you are right now, joined with his son, risen with his son, as the son, as the daughter of the Father in this very moment. What joy then you have. Oh, what manner of love is this that you are identified as. Awaken to your identity and to your destiny. It has come. Amen.
Somebody say, wow. Now say, my brain hurts a little bit. That's okay. If your hearts are full, then we're all good. If you're sticking around for dinner here, it'll be in the great room starting at 5 o'clock. If not, bless your waiter or waitresses just radically and generously, and we'll see you back here at 7 tonight.